This month, we have been focusing on missions. Missions. What does that mean? Serving, helping others, traveling, witnessing, sharing the gospel. What else? Go out into the world. Okay, that's good. The first Sunday this month, I preached about the mission, what my responsibility is as far as missions, what my and your responsibilities are. When God commands us to go out into the world and preach the gospel, Matthew chapter 28:18-20 is the great commandment that God tells us to go out into the world and preach the gospel. So have we done that? Then 2 weeks ago, we had a special missionary speaker come in, Jim Sloan. He has served the Lord over 50 years in missions, and he's still going, traveling all over. But right now, I think he is still in France, right? Okay, he is in France right now, preaching the gospel to the deaf in Paris, France. Then last week, we also had a missionary come in, Rebecca Diley. Some of you were out last week. I encourage you to please watch the video online from last week. She had a great presentation. Her vision is not the same as Jim Stone. Jim Stone is older and Rebecca is young. She's 25 years old. Only 25. And she plans to go next year in the fall to start this mission, her goal in Guatemala. And we have an opportunity to invest in missions around the world. So why do we do this? Why do we need to invest in missionaries? Because the salvation is for all people. Let's look at Romans chapter 10, verse 13. Says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Period. It doesn't say, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord and be baptized." It doesn't say, "Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord and give money to the church." It doesn't say that. It says, "Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord and serve for 50 years." It doesn't say that. "For whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your word. Help us to understand it. Help us to know what you want us to do. To go. Help us to understand what you call us to do and to do it. Give us understanding of your word this morning. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Maybe you say, well, I know that verse very well, Romans chapter 10, verse 13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But that's just a basic verse. I know that verse. Well, what does saved mean? What does salvation mean? How can a person become saved? How? First, let's look at what is the gospel. What does that mean? What does gospel mean? Gospel. It means good news. I want you to go ahead and look at 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 4. Before we look at 1 Corinthians, let's look at Romans 1:16 right here. It says, Paul is writing and it says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation. Unto salvation. To who? To everyone that believe it. To the Jew first. And also to the Greek. So the gospel is for who? People. Okay, what people? All deaf people or all Americans or, oh, the whole world? For the whole world? No. It says, for whose? It says, to everyone that believe it. So the gospel of Christ is the power of God unto salvation. The gospel is there, it says, but let's look here at Mark 16:15. I wrote this. My name is Mark. It says, and he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every who? Every creature, every person. Go into the world and preach the gospel to everyone, every person. That's a good verse, right? But still we don't see what gospel means. Let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Thank you. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preach unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. So that's a lot of words there. It says, the gospel, by which also ye are saved. Through the gospel, okay? So what is the gospel? The gospel is Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. That Jesus Christ was willing to come down from heaven for what? To die for us. Jesus Christ came and he lived as a perfect person. What a great example he was, and we should look to him and his example on earth. But he didn't come here just to be a good example. He came to earth. He was a wonderful preacher, right? We recently studied the Sermon on the Mount, and he had great things to say. He preached awesome. But was that the reason why he came to earth? He was a great preacher, yes. We look at that. But that's not the only reason why he came to earth. Did he come to earth to perform wonderful miracles? That's not the only reason why he came. We have been looking at all the different miracles that he has done on Wednesday nights. And wow, has he done amazing, powerful miracles. How did he do that? Well, is that the reason why he came to earth? So he could do miracles? No, that's not the only reason. Jesus came to earth. The most important reason was to die on the cross for you and me. To die for our sins. Our sins require a payment. Recently in Sunday school, we have been studying the book of Revelation. And it says that Christ is the Lamb of God who was killed as a sacrifice for you and I. Before we are saved, we had a big debt that we owe. We have so much sin. We owe for that. We have a debt. Let me ask you. Who's willing to admit that, oh, I have sinned a lot? Who will admit that? Who will say, yes, I have sinned a lot? My hand is up. Oh, Pastor Mark, you sin? Oh, yes, I do. And I still do. I still have sin. I'm not perfect. Not yet. So what's the point? Well, Jesus Christ came to earth to become the Lamb of God, to take away our sins. So because of all of my sin, I owe God, because Jesus came to earth and died for me, I'm free. Remember in Sunday school, we talked about the word redemption. Redemption. Paid off, free. Wow, why? Why? Because God loves us and he wants a relationship with us. So Christ came to earth, and he died on the cross. What did that look like, Jesus dying on the cross? Mm-hmm. We've talked about that. Remember when we do the Lord's Supper, we talk about how Jesus died on the cross. What did he look like? He was bloody. He bled. He was beaten. He had a crown of thorns placed on his head. How awful. And he was beaten and beaten. And the Bible says that when Jesus was walking and carrying his cross, as the people looked at him, they couldn't recognize him. His body was so torn. It looked awful. And that was what Jesus was willing to do for us. He was innocent. Jesus was innocent. I'm curious, if a cop came to your house and banged on your door and said, hey, you're coming to jail right now. And you say, oh, no, I'm innocent. I didn't do anything. No, I refuse to go to jail. I won't go. And you say, oh, well, you need a warrant. You need evidence. You need a lawyer, and you say, I'm not going to jail. I'm innocent. I didn't do anything wrong. You would say that, right? Do you think did Jesus say that? No. He didn't say anything. And the people accused him over and over, and he was just still and quiet. He didn't defend himself. He was quiet. Then the people got more angry and says, come on, defend yourself. What's wrong with you? Say something. Are you the king or not? And Jesus says, well, you made the statement. And he doesn't say anything. And the people were angry and they took him to Pilate. And Pilate says, well, this isn't on me. If you want to punish him and you want to take this on you, then is that what you want? And the crowd says, yes, his blood will be on us and our children. Crucify him. Pilate says, okay, I wash my hands. It's not on me. Go ahead. Do what you want. So then Jesus was beaten and a crown of thorns placed on his head, and they forced him to walk, carry his own cross. And then they crucified him, put nails through his hands and through his feet, and put him on the cross. And Jesus was on the cross for 1, 2, 3 hours. And we complain about standing in line at Silver Dollar City. 3 hours on the cross. How could he breathe? He had to lift, while there's a nail pierced through his feet, he had to lift himself up to take a breath. Every time. Over and over, just to breathe. Why? Why did he do this? For you. For me. He was willing to die on the cross for us. That is the gospel. Jesus' death. Well, is that the end of the story? No, it's not. After Jesus died, we buried him. After 1, 2, 3 days, Jesus rose from the dead. and he was alive again. You know, maybe we could go to the Middle East and find Muhammad's grave, and he would still be there with his bones in there and everything. Or maybe if we went to Russia and found Lenin, his body would still be there, buried. Many people have died, and we could go to their graves and see their bodies still there. But where is Jesus' grave? If we were to go there, it would be empty. Amen. Amen. It's empty. He rose again. He's alive. Amen. Praise the Lord. That's something to get excited about. Jesus Christ died, was buried, and rose again. That is the gospel. And this is our responsibility to preach, to tell others. Mark 16:15, Jesus himself is speaking here, and it says, "And he said unto them, Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature." That is the gospel. That's important. That was number one. Now, next question. What is repentance? What does that word mean, repentance? It means to change. Let's look at a few verses. 2 Chronicles 7, verse 14. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. That is the Old Testament, and that is a promise from God to the land of Israel. That's what it looks like to repent. Oh, okay. My sin. Okay, I understand. Mm-hmm. We need to humble ourselves and say, yes, God, and pray. Humble ourselves and pray. Is that enough? Is that good enough? Repeat after me. Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross. Come into my heart. Amen. And is that it? Is that the end? And now we're saved. Yay! Wait. Where's the repentance? Where? The Bible says that we must repent. Psalm 51:17, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. Oh God, thou wilt not despise. Galatians 5:24, and they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. We have sinned. Yes, we all have sin. You all admit it, right? We all have sin. So salvation happens when I go to God, understand what the gospel is, Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. Then at the same time, I also tell God, yes, I am a sinner. I come to you broken, and I'm sorry. Please forgive me for forgive me of my sins. Repentance is change. So after that, then will I be perfect from then on? No. I have been saved a long time ago. When I was a boy, I received Christ as my Savior, and I'm saved. I was saved. But then after that, does that mean I never had to sin again? Ha ha ha. I have sinned much since then. Which means what? I need to go to God again and say sorry. I'm a mess. And I repent. And I need to go and follow Him. My responsibility as a Christian is to stay faithful to Him. Romans chapter 6 says, what shall you say then? Shall you continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin continue to live any more therein? You're already saved. That means Jesus bought you with the price, and you are saved and you are free. No more are we bonded in bondage to sin. We are free, and we are righteous before God in His eyes. Number 3, whosoever. Look at Romans 10:13. Read it again. Whoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. There's a few other verses with the word whosoever. John 3:16. We all know this verse pretty well. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Everlasting life. Whosoever. Does that mean only Americans? That doesn't include the other countries, but only Americans. No, it says whosoever. God doesn't choose, oh, okay, I like you, you can. And you, I like you. God doesn't point and say, okay, you, and then forsake everyone else. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance, to salvation. Revelation 20:15 says, this is actually the opposite. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Unfortunately, there's some bad news. Yes, we have the good gospel, which is the good news. The good news. What's the good news? That Jesus, He died. He died for us. But there's some bad news. Whoever does not accept Jesus, whoever rejects God and denies God, will be cast into hell. There is a hell. It is real. Yes, it is real. It's not some made-up thing. It's not. Just like there is a heaven, there is a hell. So this is important. Salvation happens when we believe the gospel. What's the gospel? Good news. Okay, well, what's the good news? Jesus Christ died on the cross, was buried, and rose again. That's the gospel. Let me ask you again, what's the gospel? Tell me. Jesus died on the cross, was buried, and rose again. I'm going to ask you again, what's the gospel? Let me see. What's the gospel? All right. Remember that. Repeat it over and over and over. Why? Because that is the only hope for the world. The world is lost. They need medications in that. They need medication in Africa. Yeah, they do. But they need Jesus. We need someone to teach them about Jesus. Maybe medication could be given and Jesus could be given at the same time. Yeah, that's a good idea. But the hope for the world is not medication. It's not a new government. The hope for the world is not a new president. The hope for the world is not more money, better money. The hope for the world is Jesus. So salvation. Believe the gospel. What's the gospel? Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. Then we repent of our sins and call on Jesus. So now I ask you, have you been saved? If you've been saved, raise your hand. If you haven't, raise your hand. Not yet? So maybe all of us. That means all of us are saved. That's wonderful. That's good news. That's good. So you say, okay, Pastor Mark, well, that was a waste of 30 minutes explaining the gospel and about salvation. We already know this. Why are you going on and on about this over and over? We already know. We already know what the gospel is. We don't need to hear this over and over. So what's the point to this? What's the point? What's the emphasis again this month? Missions. How does this apply? Let's look at Romans 10. We already looked at verse 13. Let's look at 14 and 15. Chapter 10, verses 14 and 15. I'm going to go ahead and start at verse 13, okay? 13. 14 says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." How? How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? So to explain a clear picture of this, let me ask Ron Bagby and Chang if you can come up here, please. So picture this, that this, that he is not saved. He's lost. He has not been saved. He lives a worldly life. He doesn't go to church at all. He doesn't know who Jesus is. He hasn't read the Bible at all. Doesn't know anything about it. And here I and Chang, we go to church. We learn, we study the Bible, and we share verses with each other and encourage each other with Bible verses, and we go to church faithfully. Then this guy, how will he be saved? The Bible says, "Whosoever shall call upon the Lord shall be saved." So here we are talking, you know, about the Bible and learning, and he over here, he can't call upon the name of the Lord. Why? Because he doesn't know. He doesn't know to do that. He has no idea who Jesus is. How? How is he going to? He can't. If he doesn't know how, then how can he? But he has to hear about it. Well, how can he hear about it? Well, there needs to be a preacher. Well, how can there be a preacher? Just suppose he lives in India. Okay? Do you know where India is? Where is India? So, I say, okay, I know a person over in India who does not know Jesus. And he says, well, God had called me to go. Well, okay, you can go. And he's like, well, how can he go? He doesn't have any money. If someone says, oh, I'm willing to go to India. Okay, I'm going to go to the airport and say, hey, I'm here at the airport. Fly me to India. I'm ready to go. What are the people going to say? Where's your ticket, please? Oh, I don't have a ticket because I don't have money. But I preach the gospel, so let me go. Get on the plane. What are they going to say? No, get out of here. You don't have a ticket. They're going to call security and get you out. So how is he going to go to India? That's missions. He needs Jesus. So we, as a church, come together with money and give him money, and then other churches support him with money, and other churches around give him money, and he saves up the money, and then he can go to the airport and buy himself a ticket and fly to India. So then he flies to India, gets there, and then he's able to share the gospel, and this guy gets saved. Amen? So we believe that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And we say, amen. Yeah, that's a good verse. That's right. But do you know the percentage of death who have heard of Jesus? Both Jim Sloan and Rebecca had this about the same numbers. Jim Sohn said 2% of the deaf population are saved. Only 2%. That means 98% of the deaf around the world are not saved. That's a lot of deaf people that are dying and going to hell. We need to reach them. We have to. How? We can do it through missions, missionaries. My goal as a church. For us to come together you might say this is hard for me to give to missions because I don't have much. My goal as a church is to start with one missionary and support them for $100 a month. That means $1,200 a year. My second goal is to make an annual donation for missions work. A fund. And if a missionary says, oh, I have a special need. Maybe their car broke down or something. And we can say, oh, well, we have this fund here ready, and we can send you some money, and we can help them. My third goal is I want us to take a missions trip. I want us to go. My fourth is not only to go out into the world outside of America, my fourth goal is that we need to reach the people around us. Here. We need to reach people around us here. Maybe you say, well, I'm going to give money to the missionary. I already gave them. I'm going to give $5 a week, and that's all. So that means that's all I have to do, and I can do whatever else I want because I committed to $5 a week, and I don't have to go and witness and preach, and I don't have to share the gospel because I'm just going to give my $5 a week. No, that's wrong. Sure, we can help the missionaries with money, but it's our responsibility to reach the people here around us in Kansas City and outside of Kansas City. It's our responsibility, and that's why today we are going to Topeka. I want to see the people there to learn about Jesus and who Jesus Christ is and to become saved. Maybe we can get that 2% up to 3%. That would be great. We got to start somewhere. Maybe you say, oh, you know what? That is just too much. We can't do all that. Well, we have to start. We have to start somewhere. I would like to add a fifth goal. Pray. Prayer. We need to pray. Does prayer help? Do you think that prayer works? Yes. For sure. 100%. Yes. Pray. Prayer works. We need to pray for missionaries. Pray for people. Pray for those who are lost in the world. So, my challenge for you. Maybe you're here today and you think, well, I'm just one person. I can't change the world by myself. You know, Jesus had disciples. And those disciples spread out And they made a difference, a big change. Are you willing to give to missions? I'm asking you, are you willing to give? You say, yes, I'm willing to give. I'm not trying to make you feel guilty. That's not the point here. Oh, I feel guilty. Oh, Pastor Mark's looking at me. I guess I should give. No, that's not my point here. My point is people are lost and dying. And we need to reach them. And how? How? We have to start. We have to start somewhere. And I'm going to start. I'm going to start. And I'm going to give to missions. Are you going to join with me and make an impact to people around the world? My third question, will you share the gospel to the people here in Kansas City? Are you willing to share the gospel and say, oh, you know, have you heard of DLBC, Pastor Mark there, he preaches about Jesus Christ. Do you know who Jesus is? Have you heard of it? Heard of him? And maybe that's how you can go and explain. And maybe the person will say, oh, yeah, yeah, I know about Jesus. And maybe they'll reject it. And that's their decision. They have a choice. We can't force them to be saved and say, hey, you have to. I'm going to force Jesus in you. No, you can't do that. They either can accept him or reject him. That's their decision. My fourth question. Let me ask you. Are any of you willing to surrender and go out to the mission field? Anyone here? So you're saying I need to sell my house, I'm going to have to sell my house and my things and leave America and maybe live in another country and where maybe the language is different, the food is different, the weather is different. Are you willing? For many years, I thought God had called me to be a missionary. I really prayed about it. And it's almost like I am a missionary right now. I moved from Florida to Kansas City. The weather is different. The food is different. The language is different. The people are strange. So now I'm here. And I've become a shepherd to the church here. And I still have a heart for the people around the world, and I want to reach them with the gospel. I encourage you to do the same. You notice our theme for this month, till the whole world knows. Till the whole world knows. Does the whole world know? No, they don't. We need to share the gospel, not only here, locally, but around the world. I encourage you to come join with me, to work together in this, to reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, after this month and this missions month and how we've been emphasizing missions, and maybe you're glad that this month is over and I won't talk about it anymore. No, it's not over. I still will talk about it. We have to reach the world. Many times we become so focused on our own lives, and it's all about me and what it is here in Kansas City and DLBC. That's all we look at, and we forget about that there's people out there in the world. Do you know who these people are? Do you know? I have no idea who these people are. I just pulled this picture up from the internet. Do you know who these people are? I wonder if they know Jesus. Look at their faces. Look at their faces. Do you think he knows Jesus? That's a real person. 7 billion people. That number is so hard to understand. How many people can fit inside the Kansas City Stadium, the Chiefs Stadium? 80,000, okay. 80,000 people. Can you imagine 80,000 people inside that stadium? Do they all know? Think about it. How many stadiums are there? How many stadiums does it take to fit 7 billion people? There's just so many people to count. Can't imagine to count. A lot of them are lost and dying. Are you willing to go to share the gospel to these people? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. I feel convicted. It bothers me to see that people are lost and they don't know Jesus Christ. They don't have a relationship. They don't have real life, freedom from sin. Give us a vision to understand. And yes, we can start small. Start small and grow. And God, you know how we can do this and how people can be saved. We have to start somewhere. I pray that we would start now.